Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Sabotage. How do we know it? Who's behind it? And how much money will be involved? My guest today, Matt Cook, has written a book called Sabotage. It's published by Forge. And welcome, Matt.
Thank you, Connie. It's great to be here. I'm thrilled to be part of your show.
Thank you. And when I said how much money can be involved, not just millions, billions.
We're talking billions in this case, that's right.
Well, what is the basic that we have three different people, three different companies, worlds, trying to buy this experiment?
Exactly. So what you're talking about is a secret defense technology that's in the story that's used against a cruise ship in the North Atlantic. And it powers down the cruise ship. The cruise ship is then hijacked and used as leverage in a bidding war. So at the same time, in the story, a Stanford professor is kidnapped, and a team of his graduate students have to connect the event at sea with the kidnapping and unravel a conspiracy of global extortion.
And he has a company called Glitnet?
Glitner Defense, that's
yes.
Right.
And his name is Clare.
Exactly.
Professor Clare.
Malcolm Clare.
Now, strange man, has a daughter named Victoria.
He does.
And he is teaching at Stanford. And what very few people know is that when a professor or group at Stanford invents something, they own it. It isn't as if the college or the university owns it. They will give a piece of it to Stanford, but they themselves own what they invent there.
Well, it's quite complex. I know that there are contracts between the inventors and the university, and if the invention is created using university resources, then the university does get a cut, but this isn't really explored in the story. In the story, the professor has his own defense corporation, and through the defense corporation, he invents all kinds of weapons technologies. And it's a secret corporation, and one of these special projects is stolen, and that's what's used against the cruise ship.
You open, though, the book with somebody has saved someone, and as a result, the man who owns this marvelous ship, the Pearl, has said, you can have a free trip, and you will have the owner's cabin, the owner's suite. And my total guest for 140 days. And the man at first says, well, I don't know. And he finally is convinced, take the trip, don't be an idiot.
That's right. You're talking about Jake Rove, a former combat weatherman in the Air Force. And he enjoys sailing in Mazatlan, Mexico. And during one of his trips to Mexico, he rescues a group of teenage girls who had been following some shady characters who had been trying to kidnap those girls. And anyway, the father of one of the young ladies is a wealthy banker who, as a way of thanking Jake, says, I'd like you to be a passenger on board a cruise ship. I want it to be a world cruise. I want you to take a cruise in luxury. But Jake is not used to luxury. He's used to military, and he's served in some rather dangerous missions. And so the whole concept of opulence and of taking a cruise is really foreign to him. But he enjoys diving as well. And he finally decides, you know, I'd enjoy some of the dive locales, and he's convinced to take the cruise. Little does he know what's in store for him.
But all of which, all of these characteristics play in to the plot of Sabotage.
That was the idea, definitely, yes.
Now, you've done an interesting thing where, talk about a page-turner. You start this, and then, wait a minute, what happened to them? Because the next thing you know, you're back on the Stanford campus, and there is a young man named Austin.
That's right, exactly. So the story follows three storylines primarily. And for the main storyline, which follows two Stanford students, as well as some others on the periphery. The inspiration came from this tradition we have at Stanford called The Game. It's kind of a meta title, isn't it? The Game. But the way it works is teams of students will form, and they will race around the San Francisco Bay Area solving clues and puzzles. Each clue leads to the next clue. And the first team to finish the last puzzle and cross the finish line is the winning team. My freshman year, we got a group together. We were very excited. But after the competition, we were devastated. We didn't even finish the race. We got wiped out. And I think that one of the reasons for this is that many of the people on our team studied the same subject. So we had a couple economists on our team and several engineers. But the next year we decided, all right, this time we'll put a team together, but we'll bring together as many fields as we can. So we had a mechanical engineer, we had someone studying physics, somebody studying chemistry, computer scientist, and so on. And that year we actually won. And I was so excited by this. I thought it was really neat to see the way bringing different fields together, you can solve puzzles more effectively. And so I thought, what a great premise for a story. I'd like to have some students bringing their fields together to solve a puzzle of international consequence. And at the same time, wanted to honor the military. And that's the basis for the character Jake Rove, the former combat weatherman. And the combat weathermen are a team of special forces that I think many people haven't heard of. People have heard of the SEALs and the Delta Force, but actually what the combat weathermen do is really exciting as well. They forward deploy into hostile territories often before the SEAL teams will, to report back on the climate and the conditions of the terrain, and then the teams will go in after them.
Are they under the Army or the Navy or?
Air Force.
Air Force.
That's right.
Aha. And by the way, what did you win when you won?
Oh, it was just for fun. There was no real prize. It was just
it's
a tradition. Exactly. Yeah. Uh-huh. Exactly.
Because that becomes Austin and Victoria. Now, Austin has been asked by Professor Clare, come visit me. I have an idea for you. And what it is to become his assistant and his protege.
That's right. So Austin Hardy and Malcolm Clare, the professor, are two of the central protagonists in the story, and they have a special relationship. Austin is one of Professor Clare's students in aerospace engineering, and they have a friendly banter between them. Each challenges the other in class and outside of class. And at the start of the story, Professor Clare invites Austin into his office and says, I have a special job that I'd like to give you, but I can't tell you much about it until you tell me that you would be fully committed to it. And he gives him some of the details that would go along with this job. But Austin is really puzzled by this, and he's not sure what to say because he's given so little information. And before he can find out any more, Professor Clare is kidnapped. And so Austin then has to seek out the professor's daughter, Victoria.
Who's not too thrilled about meeting him.
Exactly.
And doesn't trust him. And he discusses, too, what time did the professor leave? And he was with me when you got that email. I mean, it's a whole, how did you figure out this timeline?
Well, you're right. When Austin goes to Victoria, the professor's daughter, Victoria is not happy to see Austin. She suspects him. It's a very strange circumstances under which he approaches her. And a lot of this has to do with the fact that she is just wary of people in general, given her father's line of work. She knows that she lives in danger. So I needed to have a way for Austin to be able to prove to Victoria that there was foul play here, that something is really out of the ordinary and that her father is probably in danger.
It's called Something is Rotten in Denmark.
Exactly. So something is rotten in Denmark and at Stanford.
At which point, because Victoria has that fantastic black credit card, which will take them anywhere in the world. So she can get them plane tickets to go to Europe to find out, where is Daddy?
That's right. Exactly.
Now, I don't want to give too much of the story away from there, but how did you plot this?
Well, in writing, they say there are plotters and pantsers, as in seat of your pantsers. So some people like to make outlines, and some people just have a general idea and go. I happen to be a plotter, so I like to outline extensively, create biographical material for the characters, and really get to know them before starting, and also will create a chronological outline, what actually happens in sequence for the story, and then also a chapter outline. So sometimes the reader doesn't get to learn all the information linearly. You learn bits and pieces as you're going along, but some of it will be out of order. So you have to decide chapter by chapter, what is the reader going to learn in this chapter? And so I try to create those two different kind of outlines, chapter by chapter, and then the chronological, and then also the biographic material for all the characters in a way that would make the plot the most interesting.
What's interesting, though, is that you are an economics major.
That's right.
That you weren't taking a course in how to write a fiction. I mean, did you learn in high school? I mean, where did that ability to, okay, fine, plotting out economics could help you there, but that linear part of writing the sentence, writing the paragraph?
Well, I knew from the age of 6 that I wanted to tell stories. I was on a family trip to Europe with my mom, dad, and grandma, and as we were driving along, I was in the back seat looking out the window, just fascinated by all the incredible geographies that we were seeing. And so I was intrigued enough to start creating a map, a fantasy land, and naming the places and the people in that map, and later develop that into a fantasy story with wizards and dragons and that sort of thing. In my early teens, I got more into suspense and thrillers. So I knew I wanted to tell stories from an early age. And then what you were saying about economics, I think if you really think hard about any two fields that might seem like they're totally different, like fiction writing and economics, you might actually discover that there are some similar threads. And between writing and economics, I would say it all comes down to incentives. Economics, at the core, studies incentives and why people behave the way they do. And in fiction writing, or at least with thriller novels, I think when you read a story, what really engages readers the most is not necessarily the action sequences or the explosions or the collateral damage or all that. It's not necessarily the action as much as the explosive interactions between the people. It's the people drama, looking at why people are behaving the way they do. What are their motivations? How do the motivations clash? So the thrill behind a thriller really boils down to incentives as well.
Well, you have enough characters so that as you're reading it, you can say, is she going to get out alive? And that's the part that is the breathtaker. I mean, especially on board ship, when you've got the two kids who are now, I guess they're in Holland or someplace, mm-hmm. but you've got Ragnar who wants to kill Jake, but Jake now, because he knows how to swim and be undersea, is underneath that big ship and discovers somebody else is underneath there laying out bombs that will explode. And although they have told all the passengers, you're going to come out okay, we're going to deliver food, they're planning to blow up the ship and kill them all.
You're absolutely right. There's a lot of deception in the story. So
yes, and in that little ship, lo and behold, who is there because he got out of the plane all right? Professor Clare. I mean, it is such a, you almost have to go back to reread, how did they get there?
Right, but there has to be an explanation for everything, and it has to be, at least for me, a game of wits. So you have the good guys and the bad guys constantly trying to outsmart each other, and think ahead of the other. And for that to really make sense, you have to have both sides be very smart and be very intelligent. Otherwise, it wouldn't be an interesting game.
Including the writer of this book.
Well, they only have a few minutes to think their things through, or seconds, but I had all the time I needed to think these situations through.
Matt, in the beginning, you thank a lot of people.
That's right.
One of whom was someone whom I said I knew because he had written some books and had been in touch, Bob Gleason.
That's right.
What did each of these people add to you?
Well, I had a lot of growing to do as a writer. This was my debut novel, and actually it all started with a man named Scott Schweimer, who was referred to me through a friend at Stanford, Howard Wolf. Scott is an entertainment attorney in Hollywood. I sent him the book at Howard's recommendation, and Scott went to Stanford as well, so he recognized a lot of the places that are described on campus, and he enjoyed the story, and he said that he would represent the work. And he introduced me to my agent, Victoria Skernick, at Levine Greenberg. Then it was Levine Greenberg, now Levine Greenberg Rostin Literary Agency. And she pitched publishers and connected the story with Bob Gleason at Tor Forge Books. And Scott...
But along the line, did any of them say, listen, I think you should be a little tighter here?
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. Scott and Victoria and Bob all did so. And it could be anything from the actual writing style to the actual plot events. Scott, at the very beginning, said, you know, there's some things here that don't quite make sense. How did person A get that information to person B? Things like this. So he went through the story with a fine-toothed comb, made some great suggestions, as did Victoria and Bob.
Okay. There's a character whom I loved very much, and I said to you, I hope he's going to be in a sequel. And you said, well, no, that isn't my next book. Itchy.
That's right. So
tell our friends who Itchy is.
Who's Itchy? So Austin Hardy's roommate is a Japanese student named Ichiro Yamada. He's from Japan. He's a brilliant mathematician and computer scientist who's won all kinds of awards. His character is actually based on three people I know at Stanford and lived closely with. And he and Austin enjoy sort of repartee together. They enjoy cracking jokes together. And so everybody calls Ichiro by a nickname Itchy, which he hates. He doesn't like to be called Itchy and is always asking them to stop, but that just makes him do it all the more.
Especially by pretty girls.
That's right. And one in particular who he has a crush on. And that would be Rachel Mason.
And I just could see them almost maybe in a separate book.
I would love to bring them back. These characters feel like old friends now. I think a lot of writers will say that when they've been with the story for a long time, with the characters that they've been developing, they feel like old friends. The next book, I felt the best way to grow as a writer was to do a standalone novel. So the next book is not a sequel. It takes place in a different time, but at some point later, I'd love to circle back and revisit Austin and the gang and bring them back.
What's the next book?
The next book, I can't say too much. All I can say is that the research has been fascinating. It's a story that takes place in the early 60s, and it's been a completely different experience writing.
When you say the research, in America or outside the
You're right to point out the story Sabotage has, it starts out in the United States on Stanford's campus, and then the students have to do some traveling to investigate the professor's disappearance and all that. And the next book as well involves a lot of traveling. The characters will start out in Wales this time, and we'll end up traveling to Paris and then several other places in Europe. I like to weave in lots of exotic locales into the story.
Does that allow you to travel?
It does. That's one of the great parts of writing, yeah. Is that there's research that you can do online and in books, but to really understand something, there's no better way to to learn about it than to actually experience it.
Question, are you an only child? When you said you had traveled with your parents and your grandmother in the back seat.
That's right. I'm an only child.
Yeah.
When I was six, though, I was desperate to have a brother. I would always ask my mom if we could go pick up a brother at the store. I didn't really understand how things works.
Yeah.
How things worked. But that's right, I'm an only child.
Because in the book, I think, isn't it, Austin talks about how he had, as a child, they would sit at dinner and talk about what had happened during the day.
That's right. I think you're probably talking about a game that Austin and his and his parents would play, or I should say his parents would play with him. And that is, oftentimes when they'd be sitting at dinner, Austin's parents would say, close your eyes, and we can do it right now if you want. So I could say, Connie, close your eyes.
Yeah.
How, let's see, what could we do? What color is the seat that you're sitting on? What color is the cushion?
All right, brown.
Very good, you got that one right.
Yeah.
So, but yeah. It's amazing when you play this game, you discover how some of the really obvious details about your environment escape you.
Yeah.
And so his parents would play this game with him so that he'd be more observant and pick up all the little details about his environment.
Well, I'll give you one in reading your book where Austin is swimming in the hotel swimming pool.
That's right.
And then he has to escape. And I thought he was swimming naked.
Oh, really?
And then it was about a couple of pages later, it said, or I guess Victoria says to him, there you were swimming in your,
Speedo or
yeah,
something
Speedo.
Like that. Yeah.
And I thought he was swimming starkers.
Not in this book.
Yeah, no, because then he was running down the street. I thought, okay, that's how he could run down the street. Yeah.
This is
something like that. Did you have to sort of figure that out?
What specifically do you mean?
Wearing a Speedo as opposed to people swimming, you know.
I think that was probably just to set up her quip, set up her reaction. And the particular brand didn't really matter. But I did want it to be an exciting scene where he's really desperate. He's actually chased out of the pool in the scene that you're talking about, and has to escape someone who's after him with a loaded gun.
Yeah. It's amazing. It's a very exciting book. However long it took, which we haven't said, how long did it take?
Well, there's the first draft, and then there's editing. And the first draft took about 3 months from start to finish of full-time work. And then the editing was several years after that. Now and then I would visit it for a week or two as sort of a part-time thing. And I would learn over those years what I liked about writing.
Yeah.
And would constantly be going back to the story and seeing ways that it could improve.
That's phenomenal. I mean, to think of you full-time student in good schools that demanded excellent work, and still being able to sit and divorce yourself to go sit and be a writer.
Well, at school I was constantly surrounded by all these kinds of stimuli. I would see brilliant people. I went to a school where I was surrounded by people who were truly brilliant people, and I was excited by this game and by the people I was with and wanted to create a story that would weave them all together. And so a lot of the characters in the story are based on my friends. They bring together all the qualities and the quirks of some of my best friends and closest friends.
Well, you did it. I don't know how you had a social life with it, but you did it during it. Anyhow, thank you very much, Matt. Will you autograph my
book? I'd be
book?
Delighted. Thank you, Connie.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson and support your local library. Some of the books you may read, interesting book by Claudette Sutton, Farewell Aleppo. It's a whole other area that I did not know that much about till I read this book, about the Jews in Syria. And the fact that in escaping because they had been really dealers. Remember the Silk Trail? Well, this was where they were people who would deal with those coming over. They sent their son to China, and he was there through World War II. Then when the war got harder, he couldn't get out of Shanghai. Then trying to get into New York, that's a whole other story. Anyhow, her father said, I think maybe it would help if you sat and told my story. She does. But these are the books you will find in your library. Support it. Take a child with you. Get them their first library card. Never forget you. Support them. Where'd you get your first library card?
My first library card was in Whittier.
And
Whittier, California.
I hope you will support libraries as you are going around with that wonderful book. And
always.
We'll see you next time. Thank you.
Thank you, Connie. Great meeting you.
Thank you.